Well, good afternoon, everybody. This is Andy Frasetto. I am coming to you from the IRIS headquarters in Washington, D.C. This is the IRIS Early Career Webinar Series, another entry in the webinar series that we're doing. And so our speaker today is Heather DeShon. Just to give you a little bit of context for how the webinar is going to work, we treat it pretty closely to a department colloquium. So we'll turn it over to Heather. She'll talk for 45 to 50 minutes, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience. The way questions can be submitted is in a box on your webinar control panel. There's a little tab called Questions. You can type them in as they come to you during the talk. I would just advise try to make sure that the question is clearly references what you're interested in. Just that at the end of the talk, it's always helps if they're very clearly posed questions or comments. And what we'll do is after Heather's done speaking, I will start reading through those and I'll try to make sure that everything gets answered before quitting time. The other thing I wanted to add is that our talk today is on SAC and Antelope. And I know many of you are probably here because you have this software and you're interested in it, interested in using it better. If you don't have either of these software packages and you're interested, the IRIS software page has these. So the address for SAC would be www.iris.edu/software/SAC. And then if you're an IRIS member, we also have a software license agreement with Boulder Real-Time Technologies, which provides Antelope to members for standard research purposes. And so the address for that is www.iris.edu/manuals/antelope.htm. So just as a reference item that I wanted to make sure everyone knew about before we started the talk today. And again, if you have any issues with audio during the webinar, just type it in as a question. We did a test earlier and I think everything was working fine. So I think without further ado, I will introduce Heather. Heather is a professor at Southern Methodist University in Dallas, Texas. She started her academic career work, getting her PhD at UC Santa Cruz. She moved on and did a postdoc at Wisconsin and was a research professor at SERI in Memphis. And she's going to talk to us today about tips and tools for SAC and Antelope. So Heather, take it away.
Thank you, Andy. So today I'll present a short overview of SAC and Antelope, and these are seismology software packages currently made available through IRIS, as Andy mentioned. For each, I'm going to provide a few short demonstrations, and the slides are going to have links throughout that guide you to websites with online help or further online tutorials. So you should be able to download this presentation after the talk, and I hope that it has some useful links for you. So I'm going to note from the outset that this presentation is really geared to students and those relatively unfamiliar with the two software packages. And there might be some tips and tricks in here, but this is really not geared for the advanced user. So, for example, I'm not going to cover how to use Antelope to make seed volumes. So just a heads up, give you a warning. Just a second. All right, so today's goals are really just to provide a brief overview. And with SAC, we're going to spend some time looking at the SAC data format. We're going to look at common sets of commands, go over a few common mistakes, and I'll introduce SAC macros. With Antelope, I'm going to concentrate on how to use Antelope to store and analyze temporary experiment data, such as Earthscope flexible array experiments or experiments run in conjunction with the Pascal Instrument Center through IRIS. And then we'll look at some ways to use IRIS Web Services with Antelope to get some transportable array data up and running on your computer. So let's start with SAC. SAC stands for Seismic Analysis Code. It was developed at Lawrence Livermore National Lab while with the University of California in the 1980s. It's copyrighted through the University of California and is now distributed by IRIS to IRIS member institutions. Now, it's a command-driven program, and it's a kind of a standard, and especially in the U.S., for data manipulation. But it's also commonly referred to for its data format. So SAC reads SAC binary data. And for a student, you might come across SAC more as a SAC file or a SAC formatted data file than anything else. So what can SAC as a command program do? First, it was written by seismologists for seismologists. So it interactively reads seismogram data. It has a number of standard data processing operations, such as filtering, the ability to add amplitude picks or phase picks, does some cross-correlation, can do trace envelopes, linear regressions, etc. It also has a set of modules that allow for visualization. All right, so this is just a pointer for the rest of this tutorial. This little percent sign is going to represent our Unix or Linux terminal window prompt. All right, so this is how do you run SAC. So you get your terminal window up, you type SAC. As long as SAC is installed, this is what you should see. So seismic analysis code and what version you're running. So this is a relatively recent version. Then in your terminal window, you'll see a SAC prompt. So your terminal window prompt will go away and you'll see a SAC prompt. Now what I have shown here is what happens when you type help. This is, with some missing text, what you would see. You'd see an introduction to SAC, and then below that you'd see a list of SAC commands in alphabetical order. So you could go back and type help space in any one of these commands. So let's pick APK. You would type help space APK, and it would tell you what the command APK does and how to use it. All right. So let's talk a bit about the data format, and in particular, the SAC header. So in SAC, each signal or seismogram is stored in a separate binary or an alphanumeric data file. So SAC can read and write a variety of formats. It can read and write its own binary format, so SAC binary format, which for me is the most common. It can actually also write CSS and SDD. It can read and write SegWi format and ASCII. Now, each data file is going to contain a header that describes the contents of that file. So let's look at the SAC header. So again, let's pretend we have our SAC prompt on our computer. We type read and then a space and the name of a SAC file. In this case, this is a broadband vertical SAC file recorded at Crystal Caves, Missouri. Right? Now it's read in. We don't see anything on our screen yet. We type list header and we would see a maybe longer version of this. So this is a partial view of what would pop up. Now the SAC header contains basic information that must be present for this to be a time series or SAC file, including the number of points, the beginning and end time, the type of file, the sampling rate, and some information about the begin time. Right? You can't have a time series without knowing a lot about time. The header also allows for event and phase information. So in this case, this SAC header contains information on the station name, the station latitude and longitude and elevation, and this was a teleseismic event. It actually has been stuffed, which means somebody has put in the event latitude, the event longitude, and the event depth. Now, the nice thing about SAC files is once they've been stuffed with the latitude and longitude and depth information for your station and your event, distance, azimuth, back azimuth, and great circle degree arc gets calculated automatically. Right. There are also a number of markers that can be set in the header. The O marker is usually reserved for origin time. The A marker is not shown here, but is usually saved for first arriving P waves. But there are also T1 through T9 markers that can be used to store other time information. So here in this example, I'm showing that the T1 marker is being used to store the arrival time of the P wave. Now, this is an arrival time relative in seconds to the begin time of the SAC file. And the begin time of the SAC file, in this case, has been set to the origin time. So the origin time is 0.0 in this SAC file. The header can also store miscellaneous information or character information. In this case, I'm storing the channel and the network associated with this SAC file. Like the channel would have to be set if you wanted to rotate your seismograms. So we're going to go through a brief example showing how to integrate velocity to displacement. And I do this because students frequently have to work through this integration, and it also is a nice short tutorial on how to use the commands and bring up some common errors about reading in files. So the first thing I'm going to do is read in another broadband vertical SAC file. This is an earthquake in India, as recorded again at Crystal Caves, Missouri. For this example, I'm using the shortcut R for the SAC command read. All right. And then I simply type plot and I plot my seismogram. So this is a SAC graphics window, or this is an X window. This is the graphics window that would pop up when you're using SAC. You can see the waveform and some information that is pulled from the SAC header. All right. So SAC comes with a command that allows integration, and the default is integration using the trapezoidal rule. The command itself is INT. So I've read in my file, I've plotted it, I type INT, I type plot again, and this is what I would see. All right, oops, this does not look like a displacement seismogram. So what happened? Well, if we went back and looked at our raw data, we would see that there was a DC offset. So this data was not originally zero mean. So when you integrate a constant, you get a line. And that is what we're seeing here, is that the line is dominating the signal. All right. Now, here's one of those things that can get students. In the memory of SAC is that worked on waveform. So SAC is thinking about that line. So you need to reread in the original file. So if I type R, it's going to automatically read in the last file that I read in. Right? So it just redoes itself. Then I can type R mean, which is going to remove the mean, integrate again, and plot again. And this is what I would see. A parabola with something resembling an earthquake on top of it. So, oops again. The integral of a linear function or a line is a quadratic function or a parabola. So what this parabola is telling us is that there's still some sort of linear function in our data. And this is pretty common. This just means our data has a trend that we need to remove. So again, we have to start over. We have to reread in our raw data. Now we will remove the mean here and remove the trend. And our trend, as the remove trend command, produces some text on your screen about the slope and the standard deviation and the y-intercept. Then we can integrate and plot. And this time, we would have a displacement seismogram. Now, there's some drift and some wiggliness, and this might not be the most advanced way to integrate to displacement, but for our example, it works. Well, now I have a displacement seismogram. What do I want to do? Or in other words, how do I save out what is in SAC memory? Now, SAC has a write command. Its shortcut is simply a W. So I type W space and then the name of the new file that I want to save out. All right, so it's important to remember that you need to write out what you did in SAC if you want to save it or look at it in the future. All right. So another useful thing to do in SAC is to use SAC to pick seismic phases. This is called the Event Analysis Module. There's two ways to do this. SAC comes with an automatic phase picking algorithm that's a short-term average divided by long-term average detector. It gets applied using the SAC command APK, which stands for automated picking algorithm. Now you can also use SAC to pick phases off of the window that we were looking at earlier. So you can pull up your seismograms and pick directly on the seismograms. And the command for doing that is called plot for picking, or PPK. So that's the example that I want to go over next, how to use PPK. Now, we could talk about PPK for 30 minutes, and we're going to use two slides. So obviously, if you want to know more about PPK, you need to open up SAC and type help PPK. So the first thing I want to show is we're in SAC, and we want to read in all of our EHZ SAC files and all of our HHZ SAC files. So EHZ and HHZ are channels. Right now, one nice thing about this example is to show that you can read in more than one file at a time using standard Unix wildcarding, which is what we're doing here. Now I'm going to start PPK, but it turns out that this read command actually would open up 16 files in the directory that it was run at from 16 different stations. And I don't want to have a window with 16 waveforms on it, because that will make it very difficult to pick P waves, for example. So instead, I say PPK per plot 2. And this is only going to place two files in my PPK window until I hit enter. And then the next two files will come up. And it is a more efficient way to work through your data. So what happens? I type PPK per plot 2, and I get this graphics window. All right, this is the PPK graphics window. Now you'll notice there's some crosshairs. Now when I screen captured this, the center of this crosshair was where my mouse was located. All right, so because we're in PowerPoint, not interactively, you have to imagine that as I moved my mouse around, these crosshairs would move around. All right. So on the side here, I have a cheat sheet of some common PPK commands, including how to zoom in and out. What I'm going to show you is how to pick a P wave. So I'm going to line up my crosshairs on where I think my P wave arrived, having properly zoomed in so I know that I'm right at the beginning of my P wave. And then I will simply type P. And when I do that, what will happen is a bar will appear with this default value IPU0. And that stands for impulsive P wave with a first motion up and a quality of 0, which is the highest quality, usually. That's the default. So if I wanted to change that, I would have to change the header value to indicate that this P wave is in fact down. But I can do that later. Now, great. I have set the P wave into the header, but now I need to save it. So what do I do? Well, SAC has, so I would type Q on this screen, and that would exit out of PPK. I'd type Q on the graphics window screen, excuse me. Then I would get back my SAC prompt, and I would type WH, and that stands for write header. So that's going to write the header only. And this is important because if you have filtered the data at some point in order to pick phases, you don't necessarily want to save the filtered version of your time series. So it is pretty good habit when using PPK and to save out using write header instead of just write, because you don't want to overwrite your raw data necessarily. All right. So moving on, next we're going to talk about a SAC macro. So far I've shown you a couple of examples that are useful for 1 or 10 or 15 waveforms, but it's especially common now that we're dealing with hundreds of stations. So we might want to do the same thing on hundreds of files. How do we do that? One way to do that in SAC is to create a macro, which is simply a text file that contains a set of SAC commands that need to be executed together. So SAC macros can take the regular SAC commands and inline functions, They can contain references to SAC header variables and to Blackboard variables, which is an advanced SAC topic we won't be talking about today. And they can also have control flow features, such as if tests or do loops. So there's a little bit of scripting that they allow. So let's look at an example. This is an example that's going to create a plot for printing. All right. So notice again that I'm back to my regular terminal window prompt. All right. I don't have SAC open. Now, I use VIM to do my text editing. So I'm going to open up a text file called plot1.macro. And you can use text edit or inedit or what or regular VI or whatever your favorite Unix, Linux text editor is. Now, inside that text file, I'm going to write a series of SAC commands. So the first thing I'm going to do is read in all three components of station BJT, which is a global seismic network station. The next thing I'm going to do is turn quick and dirty plotting off. Now, depending on how SAC starts on your computer, somebody may have written a script that actually starts SAC without quick and dirty plotting going. But the default for SAC is to decimate your time series file so that you're not looking at every data point. Now, this is very helpful if you're looking at 100 hertz data or you're looking at active source data. But in general, I find the first thing I do when I open SAC is I turn quick and dirty plotting off. Okay, this allows me to see every point in my time series file. Now I'm going to create a plot that I want to print out, and so I'm going to reset the axis, my x-axis, to be relative to the P wave that's already in the header of my SAC file. So I do that using the command xlimit. My P wave is in header value T1, and this sets my x-axis limits to be 5 seconds before the P to 50 seconds after the P. All right. Next, I'm going to create a title. The waveform we're going to look at in this case is actually a Sumatra earthquake from 2002. It was a magnitude 7.3, and we're going to look at all three channels at station BJT. Good practice is to label your X and Y axes. In this case, X is time. Y label is going to be in digital counts. Now, next is a series of commands that are going to allow us to create a PostScript file that can be read by Adobe Illustrator, Preview on a Mac, any number of things, including some line printers. All right. So we're going to begin a device that's called the SAC graphics file. And then we're going to type P1. So think of this as just plot. Now, when we do this P1, instead of seeing our waveforms on a screen, they're actually being sent in that same format into the SAC graphics file. Now, SAC creates these SAC graphics files with the following naming convention, F and then a number. So the first time you send something to a SAC graphics file, it creates F001.sgf. If you send another plot to a SAC graphics file, it's going to create SAC graphics file F002.sgf. All right. Then I'm going to in device on my SAC graphics file and then run a command that comes with SAC called SAC graphics file to PostScript. All right, so SAC graphics file to PostScript, I give my SAC graphics file and then the name of the PostScript file that I want. So I included this in the tutorial because the one thing about SAC is if you are looking at your waveforms on your computer screen, it's not like Microsoft Word or something. There's no drop-down menu for you to hit print, right? So you do have to do a little bit of legwork to get a file that you can then print. All right. So Here is what would be in our printed file. Would look a little cleaner than that. This was just due to a conversion issue. So there are two ways to run the SAC macro. You can then open SAC and then type macro space plot one macro, or you can actually run your SAC macro directly from the command line by typing SAC space plot one macro, or on some operating systems I found that SAC less than sign or suck plot one macro works as well. All right, so that was our quick overview of SAC. Moving on to Antelope. So Antelope is a software system that was designed to acquire, distribute, archive, and process environmental data. Now again, it's actually based on a set of software designed by seismologists, so it's very good for seismology data, but it can take other sorts of environmental data. It handles real-time and offline batch mode data, so if you're running a real-time system, you're having data delivered to you, this is really where most of the development with Antelope has taken place, but it was originally designed for Pascal experiments where you went out, it was originally designed and is useful for more Pascal-type experiments where you go out and get your data and bring it back into the lab and put the disk in and download a month's worth of data. So that's what I consider offline batch mode data. Now, it's the property of Boulder Real-Time Technologies, or BRTT, and it's distributed through IRIS for use with Pascal deployments, archiving with the Data Management Center, and for academic research. Now, it's important to note that when you get Antelope from IRIS, you should not be using Antelope for any sort of network operations. BRTT will sell you Antelope for network operations. All right, so what is it? It's a relational database. And then the question comes to mind, well, why do we need a relational database for seismic data? Well, seismic data is increasingly complex, right? We put out stations, they run for a long time, we switch out sensors, we might switch out data acquisition systems. There is a lot of information or metadata to keep organized. So a relational database like Antelope allows us to efficiently organize and access our data. The other thing is we really want to only type information once, and we want to keep it in a central location, right? We don't want five tables that contain station latitude where one might have had a typo introduced. Right? So this is all about keeping information centralized. And because it is a relational database, there's many tools that allow us to create and edit and combine and destroy tables. Why use BRTT's Antelope software? Like I said, it was originally designed to deal with seismic data, so that's nice, much like SAC. It contains numerous tools for processing and analyzing seismic data in many formats. So you can have one Antelope system that has SAC data and Miniseed data and anything or any type of time series data. Well, not any type, but a lot of types of time series data. It's flexible enough so that users can create their own schemas, and we'll talk about schemas in a moment, or integrate your own homegrown location algorithms or magnitude calculators. And probably most importantly, it's free for IRIS institutions. So Antelope commands. Now, Antelope comes with a lot of commands. How do you figure out what you want? It's kind of like MATLAB. First thing you could do is you could go to a prompt and type list. This is an environment setup variable that takes you to the Antelope home directory. So you can list everything in the bin. Or you could list everything in the man page directory. Or, I would suggest this, you go to BRTT's FAQ page and start from there. You can join the Antelope mailing list. You can email Pascal if you have questions. And remember that Google is your friend. So, in some sense, like MATLAB, sometimes it's just more useful to go Google or Bing. Antelope and what you want to do, and that might guide you to the command that you're actually interested in. All right, So what is a relational database? We're going to talk about the structure of the database for a little bit, and then we'll get into some examples. So first, we just have to start with some definitions. The relational database consists of tables. These tables are fixed format ASCII text files, and they're made up of records or rows or fields, which are the columns, all right? So right now, I'm showing you a table. This is the WOOF disk table for a database called April Nicoya. Contains station and channel information, the start time and the end time of the waveform, the directory the waveform is stored in, and the name of the file. So these are mini seq files. A field is going to be the columns. So these are the same attributes in every table in which it appears. So station is a good one to start with. You might have multiple tables that need to store information by station. So the station in one Antelope table is going to have exactly the same format. In this case, it is a six long character string. It's going to have the same format in every Antelope table in which it appears. The records, or the rows of these tables, form a unique combination of information. So this string of fields that make up this record is unique to the WOOF disk table. All right, well, how do you know what tables you want or what tables make up a database? That's where the schema comes in. A schema is a text file that contains the structure of the database. In other words, which tables and which fields make up a record. All right. Now, the common schema as seismologists that we use is called CSS 3.0. That stands for Center for Seismic Studies, Schema Version 3.0. This is dbhelp, is an Antelope command. This is the dbhelp for schema CSS 3.0, and we're going to just work through this to kind of understand what this means. So first we have the description of the schema and what's been changed over time. This is a very old schema, so this goes on for, we can scroll up and down, that would go on for some time. Importantly, here's the list of tables that make up the schema. Now, let's pretend I clicked on one of these tables. All right, I clicked on the WOOF disk table, and I would see this. This is called the relation statement. So it contains the relation, description of the relation, and the list of fields that make up this particular table. We can click on one of those fields, we get a different window, has a little more information about the field, so the long name of the field, and in particular the attributes that make up the field. So it's a string, this is the station field, it's a string, it's always six characters, and it has a printf format, left justified 6s, and the first character is 0, and the null value is a dash. The relation statement also contains the most important thing in our relational database, and this is the keys. The keys are going to be what allows us to link tables to one another. So there's three sets of keys. There's the primary key, or the attributes that uniquely identify the records for each table. So as long as our table has, this is our WOOF disk table, as long as it has these things, we should be pretty good. But we also need to have the direct, well, anyway, sorry. We also have the alternate keys, attributes which could uniquely identify a record, but were not chosen as the primary key. And third, we have foreign keys. These are attributes or fields of this table, the WOOF disk table, that also are primary keys of other tables in our schema. All right. So we're going to back up a minute and talk about how do you view your database. So one way is to use the Antelope command dbe, the database editor. All right. So here's an example of how to call it. I have a database. It's called April Nicoya. And I type on my terminal command line dbe April Nicoya. And what I would see is this. Okay, so all the previous examples I've been showing we're showing you tables as visualized using the database editor DBE. The other thing is that all of these tables are actually ASCII files, so I can use regular text editor or Unix commands like more. So this is just an example using more. Now this final column is interesting. It's a very long floating point number. It actually represents time. So in Antelope, time is stored in the tables in epic seconds. This is seconds since 12 a.m. on January 1, 1970. This turns all time into standardized floating point numbers and significantly simplifies calculations involving time. Now Antelope comes with a command line tool called epic, which allows you to switch from epic time to something that we would call readable time, right? So if I typed epic space now, which I did yesterday, it looks like, or Monday, you'd see the epic time in seconds. This is Julian day. This is a more traditional date. And this is the hour, minutes, and seconds in UTC. All right. Now, one of the nice things about DBE is it automatically converts epic time to readable time. So if you use more, you see epic time, but if you use DBE, you see readable times. All right, so let's go back to those keys. I'm using DBE, and I'm showing here the site table. All right, so this is information that contains latitude, longitude, and elevation of each of my stations. The primary keys are station and on date and off date, so when the station started, when the station was taken out. Next, we're going to look at the site channel table. So this is a subsetted version of the site channel table. Its primary key is channel ID, but its alternate keys are station, channel, on date, and off date. So note that both tables shown here have keys that include station, on date, and off date. And those keys can be used with the join command to link our two tables. So if I'm in DBE, I can go to view, click on join, and then I have the site channel table up in this example. So I say join with site, and this would be what I would see. So this is the join of the site chan and the site tables. They were joined using the common keys station, on date, and off date. Now you can also join on the command line, and I provide an example here. You can look at it later if you need to. So let's get to how do you create a database from scratch. Now I'm going to show you how to do this using a command called dbbuild and something called a batch file. So this is going to allow us to build an initial database of tables describing some set of metadata. We're going to use batch mode, or the minus B flag, and verbose mode. This is just so we could see some stuff on the screen. You call it saying dbbuild minus B, name of the output database, so in this case NVT is our example, and the name of the batch file. All right, so what does this batch file look like? It's essentially a text file that's going to contain a series of station block information describing various features of the experiment. So again, it's a text file. I'm going to open it up using vim. So vim batchfile.nvt, and this is what I mean by a station block. I list the start time of my station, the network, so this is the FDSN network code. This was a Pascal experiment, so the FDSN network code was provided by Pascal. Station information, including latitude and longitude. The data logger, this was an experiment done with RT-130s with the serial number was 92C1. Sensor, this was a CMG40T sensor. Had a serial number. Note that whoever's making up your batch file wants to know every detail about what was done in the field, so keep good field notes. These stations were sampled at 100 samples per second and at 1 sample per second, so I have 2 lines for sample rate. When I'm done, I type add, and then the last line of the station block should be the close time. Now you make a batch file at the beginning of an experiment, so you usually just set the close time to be when you know for sure the experiment's going to be done a couple of years in advance. So once I was done, I'd filled in all my stations. I would run DB build. Well, let's say something happened. Sensor went bad 3 months later, and I replaced it with a new sensor or a new data logger with a different serial number. Well, you just go open up your batch file and add the information. So in this case, we changed out a data logger due to some maintenance issue. In between the add and the close, I just put in a new block of information. When the data logger was changed out, what the new serial number was, and I do add again. I rerun DB build. DB build is smart. So if it already has the information, it's not going to add new, it's not going to add that information again. It's only going to add the new information. All right, well, let's get to our TA example. What are we going to do with the transportable array? Well, all of the metadata and all the antelope tables are being maintained by the Array National Facility, so you don't have to worry about that. What you can do with transportable array data is actually just go to IRIS. In this case, I'm using a web request format to download a data list seed volume. So for this example, I downloaded 1 month of metadata for the TA sometime last year. You know, this whole process takes less than 15 minutes. IRIS will make available to me via FTP a data list file that I named ta.datalist. I'm going to use an antelope command called seed2db to extract the metadata from the data list to a database. So seed2db TA data list TA example. So this is my output antelope database TA example. Then I'm going to use DBE to see what I have. And this is what I would get. I would get a CSS 3.0 set of tables. So schema CSS 3.0 set of tables here. This contains all the metadata for 1 month of the TA. Well, it doesn't contain waveforms yet because I used a data list seed volume. So the seed, everything except the waveforms. This is an example showing how to use a Perl script called fetch bulk data that IRIS makes available for use with its web services. So what fetch bulk data allows us to do is download a set of mini seed files directly to the computer from our command line. So no opening Chrome or Firefox or your favorite browser. You just do everything from the command line. So I run fetch bulk data. I specify what network I want. So this is IRIS Virtual Network US TA. So this is going to give me all TA stations. All stations, I'm only going to download the LH channels in this case. I pick a start time and an end time. This is actually an earthquake that occurred in Fiji that we're going to look at. And I set my out file to Fiji miniseed. I'm going to run an antelope command called miniseed2db, fiji.miniseed, and I'm going to send it again to TA example. And then again, I'm going to do DBE, and this is what I'd see. So these things have not changed. But now I have a new table called the Wolf Disk table. Now let's click on that. Here's my Wolf Disk table. I can go to graphics and choose waveforms. And there are my waveforms for the Fiji earthquake. Now this entire process, you get fast at it, 15, 20 minutes. You can probably even faster if you were really knowing what you were doing. You can go from having nothing to having antelope database filled with all transportable array data that recorded the Fiji earthquake. If we had a collection of SAC files that we wanted to load into Antelope, we could use the command called SAC2DB. Again, we just run SAC2DB. We point it. Here's a wildcard, so we point it to a large number of SAC files, and we send it out to a database. This database was called SiriDB. And the tables are going to be created based on the contents of the SAC header. So if your station information is in your SAC header, you're going to get a site and site channel table. If that information is not in your SAC header, you probably will only get a Wolf Disk table. After adding in data to a database, in all cases, you should run the next two commands, dbfixChannelIDs and dbfixCalib. All right, so just this is a tip. Don't forget to run these after you add data or you've modified your Wolf disk in some way. Dbmerge is a command that comes with Antelope that allows you to merge databases. All right, now I'm going to run through this pretty quickly. This is an example for automated event identification in your Antelope database. So we're going to start with a short-term average, long-term average detector called dbDetect. Now, all of these commands have parameter files. The default parameter files are located in your Antelope home directory under data, PF, which stands for parameter file. In this case, we'll look at dbDetect.parameter file. You usually need to copy this over to your local directory where your database is located and modify it as needed for your particular experiment. So for dbDetect, you might want to change the filters that are the default, depending on if you're trying to detect local earthquakes or teleseismic earthquakes, for example. It runs pretty straightforwardly, dbdetect.parameter or slash parameter file. This is just to explicitly point it to my local revised parameter file, my input database, and my output database. dbdetect is going to create a detection table, so it's going to create taExample.detection. Depending on how you have it set, this it can take a pretty long time to run. Once it's done running, your next step is to use an event associator. So dbgrassoc associates all of the detections with specific earthquakes. So this is what you use to create your initial event catalog. Again, in fact, with dbgrassoc, you actually use two commands, dbgrassoc itself and ttgrid, which stands for travel time grid. You need to copy both of those parameter files locally and modify them as needed. Then you run ttgrid first, and this is going to set up a set of travel time tables for your local experiment, or for your experiment, all right? So here's an example of how to run that. And then with dbgrassoc, it looks pretty much like dbdetect, and then at the end you tell it where to look for this new travel time grid you set up. Because remember, assoc is not just gathering detections together, it's providing an initial earthquake location. So you do need a travel time calculator there. Once that's done, you probably want to review your waveforms, add arrivals, perhaps relocate after you've added arrivals. And there's two tools that are really useful for going through waveforms in Antelope, and those are dbpick and dbloc2. Now, there are a lot of tutorials out there on these two commands. I just show you how to run dbloc2 here. I would suggest that you go and look at all of these tutorials if you're interested in how to use dbloc2. We don't have time to cover it today. All right, now here's my word on SAC, Antelope, and MATLAB. Now, SAC binary format can be read directly in MATLAB. All right, there's a number of homegrown ways to do this using matlab.m files. My favorite is called sacload. It loads the SAC header information into a MATLAB structure and the data into a vector. There's also the gizmo suite of MATLAB. This is a set of MATLAB commands to work with SAC and Antelope provided by the Geophysical Institute at the University of Alaska Fairbanks and AVO. So I think it is more common, based on what our graduate students see here certainly, to use SAC binary format in conjunction with coding in MATLAB. All right. So if you don't have a way to do this, send me an email and I can send you a .m file. Second, Antelope has a toolbox for MATLAB. Now this is contributed software provided by Kent Lindquist, so it doesn't actually come necessarily set up right away. You have to do a little work there. But what this does is it takes advantage of Antelope's ability to read in multiple file formats. So it's really easy to read in SAC and MATLAB. It's a little harder to find somebody who's written something that reads miniSeed in MATLAB, for example. So you can load up your Antelope database that contains SAC and Miniseed, and you have access to all your data in MATLAB. So this combines the flexibility of MATLAB to design your own processing streams with Antelope. Now, there was a workshop a while back led by the Pascal Instrument Center that went over Antelope and its interfaces with MATLAB and Python. So I provide the link here. There's lots of PowerPoint presentations you can download on that website. So to learn more, BRTT's FAQ page, highly useful. If you're interested in data archiving, which I did not cover here, Pascal has a number of websites. There's again the link to the PIC workshop or the Pascal Instrument Center workshop on MATLAB, Antelope, and Python. Here are the links to the SAC homepage and the SAC manual. There's also a SAC tutorial that you should go through. And if you use SAC in a publication, you should certainly reference it. So here are the SAC references. You should all thank Peter Goldstein and the SAC developers for a very useful tool. So thank you. And if you're interested in data archiving, there will be a workshop around AGU, and I provide that link. You should attend. And I'll take questions.
Great. Thank you, Heather. Yeah, that was a really great overview. We do have a few questions, so what I'll do is I'll go through them one by one. The first question was from Alexei Eminov, and he asks, where is the locations code stored inside a SAC file header?
The location code.
Yeah, for the station.
Yeah, the 00 or the 10.
Right.
I have to say I don't know offhand. I would go to the SAC manual under data format and just see where that should be stored. Maybe somebody else in the audience knows and can just type that in real quick.
Yeah, I can also look for it while you're answering the next question. So next question is from Justin Brown, and he asks, is it possible in SAC to do derivatives and, you know, for example, displacement to velocity?
Yes, there is a command for that.
Okay. Question.
I have in SAC open. I just can't remember some of these things offhand.
No worries. I can try to look for that. Okay, so the next question is from Ray Sakir. If I use acceleration data to get displacement, I'll do double integration. Should I perform rtrend two times?
Again, I feel bad. I'm like 0 for 4 now. I think I would actually just test it real quick. I mean, it should be pretty clear if you needed to do that.
Yeah. I have an answer for the location one. I just dug up a SAC seismogram. I think it's K-hole, K-H-O-L-E, has my location codes in it. So that might be the same for others.
Yeah.
Question from Sharar Barak. If you have more than one site, and this is an Antelope question, I should say, preface. Yeah. If you have more than one site and you need to update an equipment change, how does Antelope know which site you mean to update?
So, to me, this is the advantage of using batch files. I didn't mention that dbbuild is also a GUI that you can use. I'll just flip back because I actually provided an example. But I went through it really quickly there at the end. All right, this is how you would do that. So you'd open up your same batch file, and then in between your initial setup, so after your first add, but before the close, you put in the new information regarding the equipment change. And then again, you type add. So usually when you have an equipment change, you start with the time of the equipment change. You keep track of the equipment change. And by putting this block of information in between when I started information about this particular station and when I closed this station, that's how dbbuild knows what station that was for. right? It's because it is between the call to station and the call to close that station. Now, if you did a bunch of equipment changes and you did the same equipment change at five stations, yes, you'd have to actually write this block of information in for each station.
Okay, great, thanks. I've dug up the answer to Justin Brown's question. The function is called, it's very easy, it's a diff, D-I-F. We'll do differentiation. Okay, next question's from Bill Harbert. The TA example as both input and output for the event detection means that the events are being placed into the TA example Antelope database itself, question mark?
Yes. Yes, so when you run dbgr-soc, it is going to create, in the example I gave, it's going to create taExample.event, taExample.origin, taExample.associ, and taExample.arrival. Okay, so that is going to be the tables that contain information about the initial events and what stations and what arrivals are associated with those events.
Okay, great. Bill Harbert has a question. I don't know what the answer is to this. Yes, is there a single PDF for the entire SAC manual? I could not find one. That was his question.
I always use the SAC manual online, and I mean, I have seen printed versions. I mean, it takes up a three-wing binder.
Yeah.
So it would be a pretty big PDF.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now, Bill, as well. I mean, it's at iris.edu/software/sac/manual.html. I don't think there is a PDF version of this, but it's pretty user-friendly just clicking around it. So it might be a matter of just printing it out if you need it that way. Let's see. Few more questions. How do I get to display the waveforms only on the channels on which they have been detected on? SWD command in dbpic doesn't seem to give me what I want. And that question is from Shahar Barak again. Or I'm sorry, actually from Jubril Davies.
Okay. I'd have to play around with dbpic to answer, but I can tell you in dblope 2, if you opened up your database in dblope 2, there's actually a drop-down menu that specifies detections vertical or horizontal or all. So there's actually just a simple drop-down menu that you can use to look at only those waveforms with detections or only those waveforms that are vertical or only those waveforms that are horizontal.
Okay, I have a question from Esteban Chavez. Can I extract response files in seed format from Antelope?
So when you create the Antelope tables using a seed volume, so seed2db, Antelope will create a directory called response where it places the response information. Now it's important to note that if you use readseed to extract response files, for example, that's not the response file format that Antelope likes. So when you use seed2db, it will create a response directory, and it will create a number of tables, the sensor table and the calibration table and the instrument table, that point back to that response. And now one of those tables, I can't remember which one, has a graphics drop-down menu where you can say view response, and it's going to graph the response for you.
Okay. I had another question from Shahar Barak. Is there an Antelope GUI in which you can filter and QC data?
I would send that question to Pascal. I'm not so sure about that.
Okay.
Or if somebody from Pascal is listening in, maybe they can answer.
Yeah, I know George Slad's in here. George, if you're still in the room and you know the answer to that, you're welcome to chime in.
I mean, again, if you just want to filter your data, you can look at filters. You can design filters that can be read by dbpic or dbloc2, and you can do it that way. You can load up your waveforms in dbpic and then apply that filter. I don't find filtering as easy in Antelope as it is in SAC. So a quick pulling up of a waveform to look at its filtered version is something I still rely on SAC for. But that's only because there's essentially a parameter file that you design with the filters that you're interested in. So it's just not quite as flexible or interactive. It doesn't have, so Antelope doesn't allow for just as interactive filtering like SAC does.
Yeah.
Or even MATLAB.
One question, actually there's been several questions asking if this webinar will be available for viewing afterwards. I sometimes forget to mention that at the outset, but it will. It's being recorded right now, and we'll post it up on YouTube and have it linked through the standard IRIS webinar page that was advertised in the email for this. So keep a lookout for that. It'll be up in the next day or two. So report back from George. He says, Pascal says dbpic would be the way to do it in Antelope, but personally, Mouse chimes in with this, PQL would be a better waveform QC tool. And so PQL is another piece of software that's available through the Iris Pascal and Iris DMS. Let's see. Trying to sift through all these questions. There's a lot of happy comments, Heather. People are very thankful that you were able to do this today.
So well, you're welcome.
Yeah. Let's see.
A lot of these slides, just for a little bit of self-advertising, a lot of these slides were pulled from a series of lectures I give on SAC and Antelope on courses. So I listed in there, in the slides, there's a link to my course, basically. And there's just more information. I mean, the SAC portion is like 4 hour long PowerPoint slides, and it was 20 minutes here, so.
Great.
I'll look that up.
There's a question from Igor Stubayo. What is the difference between using N equals 2 and N equals 4 in the Butterworth filter in SAC?
So the P is the pole and the N is, I'm going to have it backwards. Is N the pole and P the number of passes, or it might be the other way around?
So his example command was BPN2 and then the corner command with the two corner frequencies. I think N is number, I think it's poles.
N is number of poles, yeah.
Yeah.
So N is number of poles and P is number of passes. So you're just setting up your filter to have the two poles. I don't really know if we really want to get into poles and zeros.
Yeah, that could be opening up a real can of worms.
Yeah.
There's some documentation on the manual page for that, though. So I would.
Yeah, there is. I mean, if you type help BP, it provide some information about poles and zeros. I mean, if you really want to know about poles and zeros, right, go read Sherbaum's book. But MATLAB is also a little nice in that way because you can design your filters and you can actually look at kind of visually what all that looks like, the poles at least.
Okay, I'm just doing one last sift through this to see if I missed anything. Let's see. Oh, Justin Brown does add that there did used to be a single PDF, and he says it's hundreds of pages long. So it's probably floating around somewhere out there on the internet. For this.
Yeah, probably. But it probably hasn't been updated. I mean, haven't seen a printed comp. I haven't. A lot of seismology labs have a printed version of the SAC manual, and they were usually printed 10 or 15 years ago. So.
There's a question from Jackie Kaplan Auerbach. And she's asking, can you talk a bit about syntax for MATLAB commands such as subsetting?
Learning the syntax for MATLAB and Antelope is certainly, I understand why she's asking the question. it's one of those things where unless I had an example in front of me and I had MATLAB open.
Oh, sorry, she means Antelope commands, not MATLAB.
Let's see, did I have.
Sorry, that was my mistranslation. Sorry,
That's all right.
Jackie.
Oh, that's funny. I had a nice. So this one, this DB join, it actually did have DB subset pipe too, and then my students told me that I was getting too complicated. So I got rid of it. So in some sense, DB subset, you'd write DB subset here, DB subset, what table you're interested in subsetting. And where the syntax gets tricky is the use of double quotes versus single quotes. I think the flag is minus S. And then in quotes, you can list a bunch of commands that you're subsetting. You can use a double ampersand or a double bar for and an or, so it takes logical things. But Jackie, I would just email me your pieces, your subset command that isn't quite working, and I'd rather just look at it. I just don't know what else to say.
Okay. I have a question from Derek Schutt. He's curious if you find Antelope useful for processing data that you download from the DMC. And then he adds, he personally doesn't use it, just a combination of shell scripts, SAC, and MATLAB, but is wondering if he's missing something by not doing that.
No, he's not missing anything. So this, if anyone out there from VRTT or Pascal Instruments Center is out there, this is my own personal opinion. I find Antelope useful for running experiments and getting earthquake location catalogs. The gizmo package is something I don't have a lot of or any experience with. It looks like it does some really cool things using Antelope and MATLAB. And I do have students that use Antelope essentially as an organization of tool to go run stuff in MATLAB. Okay, so if you have trouble organizing your data, well, yeah, maybe you want to use Antelope, but for some things, shell scripts and SAC, MATLAB are still more efficient. So it just depends. Like if I was trying to get an initial earthquake catalog, yeah, I'd use Antelope. But if I was trying to rotate and do surface wave work or whatever, I'd probably throw my stuff into Antelope because I know it well, and then use MATLAB. But Antelope has a kind of steep learning curve. So if you already have something that works for you, maybe it's not worth it. My own personal opinion.
Thank you. Yeah, that's good to know. Well, I think that's it in terms of questions. So, if everyone can sort of clap in your offices around the country, this was great, Heather. This was extremely useful, and I think this was our best attended webinar by far. So I know that
Good.
this is a topic of some serious interest in the community. So I appreciate you taking the time out of your afternoon to do this.
No problem.
Great. And
Thanks.
go ahead. Sorry.
No, I just thank you for inviting me and
Yeah.
Harmony and the EIC group.
Our pleasure. Yeah, it was great to have you. And everyone else out there, as I mentioned earlier, this has been recorded. It'll be up on the website tomorrow. And if you have any other questions or concerns, feel free to email me when convenient. Okay. Thanks, everybody, and have a good rest of your afternoons.
Bye.